So I know you just clicked on a thumbnail that talks about roundabouts, but real quick, the stoplight here this corner, this was the site of the very first automated stoplight in the state of Indiana, invented by a guy named Leslie Haynes, who 100 years ago was sitting in his office, which used to be right here. They tore the building down. Though if you look at historic photos, it really wasn't that special of a place. So let's imagine instead the next door, it was here in a nondescript brick building like this one, surrounded by elevator equipment, that Leslie Haynes invented the first automated traffic signal in Indiana.
Which the town proudly displays in this museum.
Which I wanted to show it to you, but they've moved the museum.
To build a new foundation.
I don't think it's on display today, so I can't show you. But here's the kicker. A town that's super proud of having this very first stoplight is ripping all of their stoplights out.
For Jim Brainard, his fascination with roundabouts goes clear back to his college days.
So I had seen the roundabouts when I was in grad school in England. I knew nothing about civil engineering, so I started asking lots of questions. I was a history major and a lawyer by training. The engineers couldn't really tell me why we had traffic lights and not traffic circles.
When he won election for mayor of Carmel in 1996, there were no roundabouts in his city. In fact, there were almost no roundabouts in the United States at all.
Go to the engineering libraries and pull articles and learn that roundabouts are much, much safer.
When a stoplight turns yellow, we all tend to speed up to try to beat it. But a roundabout, you have to slow down for those, which cuts injury crashes in half. So the mayor decided to use his new public office to try to fix the traffic mess near Carmel High School.
We have our beautiful public library right across the street from our 5,000-person high school.
And when school gets out,
they describe it as a zoo-like atmosphere with parents pulling up to pick up their kids, mixing with the kids who are trying to cross the street in front of non-parents who don't know school is out, and it's just a big mess.
The city needed to get drivers to slow down and cut down on the left turns that were blocking traffic.
Walks into the mayor's office with his first big idea.
Put a roundabout at each end of the school on the library campus, then have a raised crosswalk in the middle.
Today's engineers would call this a gateway effect. A roundabout telling a driver, hey, something's changing, so you better pay attention.
But this was the late 1990s, and Indiana had never tried anything like this. America had never tried anything like this. But that didn't stop the mayor from going ahead and trying anyway.
He asked the city council to approve $480,000 building two roundabouts, a raised median, and that crosswalk. The goal? Back-to-back roundabouts might get drivers to slow down a little bit.
Nobody's going to just nail on the gas coming out of the first roundabout here. When they see a block down the street, there's a second roundabout, right?
Because you have to slow down in the roundabout. Then they realize they're in a tighter area with lots of people walking.
A University of Michigan study showed a 90% drop in fatal crashes at roundabouts. The city's traffic engineer liked that. The school district liked the idea too. The neighborhood was a little more skeptical.
This church, across the street from the high school even, they came to the meeting and said, well, we're not opposed to the roundabouts. It's that median you want to put in front of our church. Cut an opening so people can turn left, then we're totally fine with it. But the mayor responded to the meeting and said, well, the cool thing about two roundabouts is, yeah, you can't make a left turn into the church directly, but you go a little past it to the roundabout, make a U-turn, come around, come back, and make a right turn, and you're there. It adds a few seconds, and it's a lot safer.
A normal left turn causes delays while you wait to pick a gap to turn left in front of traffic that could cause a pretty bad accident, since they'd be hitting the side of your car. But make the drivers use the roundabouts to make a U-turn, and sure, they could get into a couple of fender benders, but those would be simple side swipes at a safer, slow speed. And sure, this project would cost a lot more than a stoplight now, but over the long haul,
after 20, 25 years, a stoplight, the apparatus wears out, the cables or the post wears out, and all has to be replaced at $400,000 to $800,000 again, plus whatever inflation's been.
And traffic signals have ongoing costs to set the timing and fix them and pay for electricity. But a roundabout doesn't really have much electronic equipment to fix. That saves money. It really looked like a project that was all upsides.
So the city council voted on it unanimously, 6-0, against it.
Ouch! Indiana was just not ready for roundabouts. One council member saying, oh, there's just not enough public safety concern to justify spending that kind of money on landscaping. The former police chief called the project pretty, but it won't solve the problem. And the few neighbors who did turn up were all in opposition.
And it was I'd beaten the incumbent, and it was near his neighborhood. I thought we'd try one there. The guy I'd beaten, it was his chance to come and explain that that wasn't a good idea with a bunch of his neighbors and friends.
In a lot of cities, a humiliating failure like this would be the end of the Roundabout program.
But as you can see, the Roundabout got built, and that one down there got built, and 149 other roundabouts got built just in this town. This is the story of how a skeptical little suburb in middle America, like thousands of other towns in this country, tried something different, and it's kind of working.
And although I couldn't get the mayor to admit it, this is how the mayor kind of cleverly tricked the city into building their first few roundabouts. How do you pronounce the city's name?
Carmel.
Carmel.
Caramel, dude!
The sponsor for this video is you! And 600 others who contribute directly at patreon.com/roadguyrob.
There's a lot of confusion with people from those parts of the country that that's what we're building here, but that's not what we're building.
For most of the 20th century, America didn't have roundabouts. They had rotaries, like this one I saw outside of Boston. And having a driveway inside the circle is so unroundabout.
They're allowed to switch lanes within the rotaries. Oftentimes, you're not angled when you enter and leave those old rotaries.
In fact, one of America's first rotaries is just a half hour south of here. But we'll talk about that in the next video. It wouldn't be until 1990 when this science experiment showed up west of Las Vegas in Summerlin, the first modern roundabout in the United States. One that helps drivers properly slow down, yield, and merge their way into the roundabout, with that counterclockwise traffic inside the circle always having the right of way. A town in Maryland was up next, Lisbon, in 1993, with one 73-year-old woman saying, "I didn't think it was a good idea at first, but then she drove it. I totally agree with it now." Colorado were the first to put a roundabout on a freeway exit in 1995. It was in 1997 when a window opened for Carmel, Indiana, to build two more.
We were building a new road on the east side of Carmel called Hazeldale Parkway, and that was our first big project. The road didn't exist. There wasn't any development along it. I had appropriation from the city council to build that road. At the time, it was about $25 million, and we decided to add two roundabouts to that road.
And that's where he got clever. The council approved the project, but they didn't need to approve every single little engineering detail of the project.
Construction crews were building the road in an area that back in 1997 was mostly open fields. So there weren't a lot of people watching really closely, neighbors and city council members. And that gave the mayor an opportunity to sneak his roundabouts in.
It wasn't until construction was almost finished that the city council members found out. And a few were pretty mad about it. One wanted to castigate him, or publicly reprimand, accusing the mayor of purposely muddling communications because of what had happened the year before over by Carmel High School. But the mayor told the council he insisted roundabouts were not clandestine. He said, "We told the newspaper months ago about a contract for a landscaping project that involved two circular intersections. So see? I'll leave it to you to decide if this is adequate notification for a city council." But once they saw the roundabouts up close, several council members conceded they looked pretty good and might actually save the city some money in the long run. But if you want your city to let you build more roundabouts, the engineering has to be perfect.
Now for a city designing a roundabout today, it's really easy. You get out the book, you look at what the standards are, and follow engineering best practice. But in the 1990s, there was no manual.
I wrote to British Transportation Secretary as well as our Australians. Somehow I think my letter got lost in England, but the Australians sent over a big fat book of standards. We later learned their standards weren't really up to snuff.
The magic that makes roundabouts safe is every car has to slow down to about 10 to 15 miles an hour to drive around the circle. But there was something wrong with the two Hazeldale roundabouts. Drivers weren't slowing down.
We were having too many fender benders in them, but there was a British engineer working in the United States.
The British consultant took a look at the roundabout and said, "You know, this island in the middle is a little too small, and the approach roads are a bit too fat along Hazeldale, and that's letting cars just charge right along and treat this like it's a two-way stop, and they don't have the stop sign."
Some fairly minor adjustments to the sight lines and angles would make a huge difference. And so we learned as we went.
By tightening up the entries and exits and making the circular island fatter, drivers in smaller cars lose that straight path, which means they actually have to slow down and go around the circle.
The lessons engineers learned here in Carmel on their first two roundabouts helped the federal government literally write the book all roundabouts across the country follow today.
So we now have great standards. So if you see a roundabout in California or Colorado or New York or Indiana, it's going to be the same signage, the same type of construction for the most part.
The mayor tells me the original Hazeldell project had 6 intersections, only 2 being roundabouts. The other 4 were lights. The worry back then was if an intersection saw more than 25,000 cars a day, the roundabout would clog up and fail. In the years since, engineers have learned that daily traffic counts don't really matter. It's how many cars show up each hour. And if you do have an hour that's too busy, there are a couple of tricks. For instance, if a lot of the traffic is making a right-hand turn, you can build a slip lane and then subtract those cars from the hourly count, since those drivers are bypassing the circle entirely. And that makes a roundabout compatible with most suburban intersections. So how exactly did Carmel, Indiana go from being unanimously against roundabouts to being America's roundabout capital? Well, after the city council warmed up to the roundabouts on Hazeldell Parkway, they okayed a series of new roundabouts on the city's west side, a street that parallels U.S. Highway 31. On the Institute of Transportation Engineers podcast, the city's transportation engineer says, sometimes this street outperformed the highway during rush hour, which is good for business because cars keep moving. But the city didn't let the good news just speak for itself. They collected that hard data, they used it to make the case for building even more roundabouts, holding public meetings, putting shows on public access cable TV. I just hit a tree.
No.
There it is. Poor thing. Even mailing out postcards to everybody in town. And so when I bumped into a random Carmel resident on the side of the street.
Well, widening it increases the capacity where you don't need it. Roundabouts increase the capacity where you have your bottleneck.
Evidently, this city has some of the best roundabout literacy in the country. With each new roundabout the city built, people seem to like them better and better.
I couldn't take a roundabout out today if I wanted to.
Yeah.
People in Carmel love them. We've polled, I do my political surveys, it's well over 90%.
Carmel is really satisfying to drive through because with no traffic signals, you never stop. You just keep moving and moving. It's pretty great. Oh, by the way, you know those first two roundabouts that got voted down? Those also finally got built about a year or two ago. Now, what do you do about a crazy state highway that's just slammed with traffic? The kind somebody would be a fool to try to cross on foot.
That would be taking their life in their hands to cross.
Next time, I take my life into my hands. And the story of how a roundabout saved a busy, broken highway.
We have not had a fatality in that road where we usually had 1 to 2 per year.
Coming up in part 2. Coming up on the Behind the Scenes podcast, the Oregon Bridge disaster this month that thankfully is not really a disaster. A longer conversation with Mayor Brainard and the fate of my poor little Mavic Mini drone. Listen now at patreon.com/roadguyrob just for contributors like you. Thanks for watching.